this great opportunity to be back and of course to see a lot of friends here. It's been a wonderful experience to be home once again. I'm not gonna get tired of saying this, that I'm always indebted to Southampton Church. In fact, after just mentioned it a while ago. So praise God for that. Praise God for that. First, before we start, shall we bow our heads for the word of prayer? Gracious Lord, and we would like to invite again that presence of the Holy Spirit to be amongst us, to open our hearts, our minds, our ears as we listen to your word today. May today's worship, Lord, will be a life-changing experience for all of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. New Year is coming. 2018 is coming. It is, you know, they always say that New Year is always a year of a new beginning. And I believe that a lot of people make a lot of New Year's resolutions. You know, they always wanted to make changes in their lives. Now, friends, let me ask you this question. Suppose you could change anything about yourself. Where would you start? Where would you start? I believe that lots of us would actually start on the outside. Right? So would you be skinner? Would you be taller? Would you be shorter? Would you be better looking? Would you change your hair? Would you change your teeth? Would you change your nose? Would you change your legs? Would you change your bulges? You know, if you could wave a magic wand and change your outward appearance, would it be just a light touch-up or an extreme makeover? If you do, would we even recognize you? Friends, I think that we all go through periods where we desperately want to change our outward appearance. Young people, teenagers, they live in a state of constant fear that they don't look good enough. And that's the very reason why they try this fad, they try this fashion. You know, whatever the latest hip-hop artist happens to be wearing. And of course, as we grow older, we get smarter, do we? Well, actually, we spend time, hours, just to try, just to find the right dress, the right shirt, the right pair of pants so that we will fit in with whatever crowd we are trying to impress. Yes, we diet obsessively, we go to gym obsessively, which is actually good for health, but it can be a losing battle, friends, especially after we lose that weight, after we look good, and then it tends to come back again, those weights. And in extreme cases, we may just give up altogether and stop caring how we look. But as hard as it is to change on the outside, it seems infinitely harder to change on the inside. If there's anything we know about human nature, it is that people change slowly if they change at all. Now, friends, think about the struggles of your own life. What would you change about yourself on the inside if you could, if I could? Would it be an impatient spirit? Would it be a critical tongue? Would it be envy of those around you? Would it be a spirit of discontentment? Would it be lust you can conquer? Would it be financial mismanagement? Would it be a guilty conscience? Would it be an inability to work with others? Would it be a judgmental spirit? Would it be a temper? Would it be an inability to appreciate life? Would it be an ungrateful spirit? Would it be a disorganized life? Would it be an inability to say no? We all want to change something. We all want to change something, don't we? But we don't know how to do it, and we don't know where to begin. We all dream of becoming something different, something better than the person we are today. But friends, let me tell you, change is hard, isn't it? It is hard. It is hard if we don't allow God to change us. You know, God always intends that we will slowly but surely be transformed into the image of Christ. Friends, today, let me share to you one of the most important aspects of life that we need to consider. And this aspect does not only do for our the good of our spiritual lives, but also it does do good to the physical aspect of life. And this is about forgiveness. Our ability to forgive. Allow me to share to you an illustration that used by Dr. Chile in one of his presentations. 1844 France, a man by the name of Alexander Dumas wrote a book that became a masterpiece art of his work, of work of art. And the book was entitled The Count of Monte Cristo. I believe that some of us here read that book or perhaps watched the movie. I've watched the movie of this. The Count of Monte Cristo. Now, this Count of Monte Cristo actually captured the interest of the people in his time. Now, the Count of Mount Monte Cristo is a story of revenge. For those of watch, may I see the hands of those who watch this film? Hurt you? Try it. It is a story of revenge. It is a story of a man by the name of Edmond Dantès who was betrayed by his best friend. His wealth, his fiancée were taken by his best friend. And what made it worse is that Edmond Dantès was put into prison by his best friend. And while he was in prison, his father died in poverty. You know, at that time, there's only one thing in the mind of Edmond Dantès, and that is revenge. The moment he would get out of the prison, he would definitely take a revenge. He wanted to kill his best friend. For Edmond Dantès, revenge is sweet. He understood it as revenge is sweet, but it has after bitter taste. Friends, the antidote to revenge is what we call forgiveness. Forgiveness. Now, some people think that forgiveness is something that only religious people do. Is that true? Interestingly, medical doctors have discovered forgiveness can be a secret weapon of getting rid of anger and bitterness. In fact, not only that, they also discovered that forgiveness can improve someone's health. You know, people can hurt us in a million of ways. And forgiveness is not always easy. Whether we've been betrayed by a friend or betrayed by our spouse, perhaps someone has cut us off in a traffic, or perhaps someone has bad-mouthed us in our working place. Forgiveness is not always easy. And I believe that most of us are faced with a variety of situations that we can actually choose either to revenge or to forgive. As I have said, friends, forgiveness is easier said than done. Forgiveness can be difficult when the person who wronged us does not seem to deserve our forgiveness. And that's what makes it so difficult. To forgive is very challenging because it's hard to let go of what has happened. But friends, we are still admonished by the Spirit of God to forgive, to let go. And here are some reasons, the benefits of having a forgiving heart. Forgiveness is good for your heart, literally. One study from the Journal of Behavioral Medicine found forgiveness to be associated with lower heart rate and blood pressure, as well as stress relief. This can bring long-term health benefits for your heart and overall wealth. Another one, research in this area is growing fast, so there is increasing evidence that the anger, blame, hostility, and grudge holding associated with lack of forgiveness are what? Damaging to health, and that individuals who forgive tend to enjoy better health and greater life satisfaction. A lot of benefits when we forgive. So what is forgiveness? Well, this is the common definition of forgiveness. Forget, a forgiven, forget. Is this true? Does it really work? Forgive and forget. But friends, before going into the definition of forgiveness that I got from Dr. Tibbetts, the author of the book Forgive to Live, let us go first to what forgiveness is not. Okay? What forgiveness is not. Forgiveness is not forgetting. Now, some people believe that if you have not been able to forgive or forget some unpleasant event, then you must not have forgiven the act of the one who acted against you. But friends, this idea could not be true. If it were, then only those individuals with memory loss who would be able to forgive. We may never forget those things which affect us deeply, because forgiveness does not wipe out our memory. The test is not whether we remember it or not, but it is how we remember it. Forgiveness is not condoning. Forgiveness never makes a wrong right, nor condone or excuse the wrong act. Forgiveness is not denying. Forgiveness faces issues rather than hiding from them. The fourth one, this is interesting, forgiveness is not pardoning. Certainly, forgiveness can involve pardon, but it doesn't have to. We can forgive and still hold them accountable for their legal and natural consequences of their actions. Forgiveness does not suspend the law of cause and effect, not at all. But what changes is this, is our desire for vengeance and retaliation. And that change, friends, helps us to avoid an escalation of retaliation or attack and counterattack. The last thing, what forgiveness is not, is reconciling. Now, this is interesting. What does it mean to say that forgiveness is not reconciling? Often, forgiveness can lead to reconciliation, but not always. It takes two people to reconcile, but only one to forgive. Only one to forgive. Even if the other party refuses to participate in forgiveness, our ability to forgive remains unhindered. We can forgive, friends, brothers and sisters, whether or not the other person is involved. Now, we know what forgiveness is not. So what is forgiveness? What is it? According to Dr. Tibbetts, the author of Forgive to Live, he said that forgiveness is a process. Friends, always remember this word, it's a process of reframing one's story from the past with the goal of recovering one's peace in the present and revitalizing one's purpose for the future. It involves the past, the present, and the future. And in fact, according to him, when you look closely at this definition, you will find three divided or distinct phases. Number one is how we handle the memories of painful things said or done to us in the past, how we overcome the negative emotions we feel right now, and how we free ourselves from a hurtful past to achieve our desired future. As I've said, it is a process. It doesn't happen overnight. Now, life is not fair, true or false? Some say it was true, some others know it's false. But most of us, I believe, most of us believe that it should be, right? It should be. And why not? It's only fair that life, what? Should be fair. And every one of us wants to think that we are guaranteed a share fair in life. We want to think that way. That we are guaranteed a fair share in life. Now, for example, if I am a good man, okay, good things should happen to me, right? Time, I'm a good man, right? Life should be fair. Life should be fair. But friends, this is the kind of idea or belief that actually causes us a lot of heartaches and makes forgiveness so hard. Why? Because even if we think life should be fair, the truth is, it often is not. That is a fact. That is the reality. We want to think it should be fair, but often it's not. And so, when a harm has occurred in your life, we hope the offender will what? Will apologize, will make a restitution, will care about our happiness. But the truth is, the other person has gone on with their life. They don't care. We are left suffering, and that is not fair. While we know we should forgive, the truth is we often do not want to forgive. Because it's not easy to let go of deep hurts, is it? We ask this question, well, after all, why should I forgive? We ask that question, well, I did not do anything wrong. The other should be punished. Why should I let the other off the hook? No, these are the common reasons why we find ourselves hard to forgive. Now, friends, the truth is when I forgive, I let myself off the hook. But when I do not forgive, I am the one left with the pain and what? Misery. Misery. When you do not forgive, you are in effect handcuffing yourself to spend the day with a person that you don't not want to be with. And no wonder you had a bad day. No wonder I had a bad day. Because look who we spent it with. If we spend our day thinking about the person who made our lives miserable, we will definitely have a miserable day. So why do that to ourselves? That's the question. Now here's the insight. Vengeance hurts you more than the other person. Forgiveness helps you more than the other person. Friends, holding on to a grievance against someone who has offended us will not make things better, no. Nor will it make things right. In fact, just the opposite. It makes things worse. And here is the real irony of this. While we are seeking to punish the other person, the only one suffering is you and me. And how do I know this? Because we are the only one who is still hurting. The other person has gone on with his or her life. They no longer care about us. In fact, perhaps some of them have already been dead quite a long time ago. While forgiveness does not make life fair, it will keep your past from destroying your future. So friends, let us not live a miserable life because of what someone else has done to us. The essential question of forgiveness is not who did what, but will I allow this event to ruin my life or to enrich it? Pain is inevitable. Misery is what? Optional. Optional. Don't live a miserable life because you're stuck in your pain. So, what do we do? Avoid the blame game. Oh, it is all your fault. Oh, it is your fault for how I feel. Oh, it is your fault for the misery in my life. Oh, my life is your fault. Friends, blame is about shifting responsibility. Blame is like addiction. It makes you feel better at first, but in the long run, it will what? It will destroy you. So when I blame the other person, I give them control over my life, hoping that they will apologize and make things better. No! But when I forgive, I take responsibility for my life. Responsibility, two words, response and ability, is our ability to choose our response. So friends, you can complain and blame, or you can what? Forgive and live. The choice is ours. The choice is ours. As I have said, forgiveness is a process. It doesn't happen overnight. But friends, while pondering about this process, the idea of forgiveness, let us revisit forgiveness in Scripture. You know, the grandest theme in the entire Bible is the unfolding of God's plan for our salvation. How does God save us? How? He does through the healing power of forgiveness. Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." Romans 6:23 reminds us that the wages of sin is what? Death. The reality is every one of us needs forgiveness because we all have sinned. And without God's forgiveness, friends, we would all die with no hope for the future. But the good news is this. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. You know, Jesus' life and teachings actually revolve around forgiveness. You know, when he taught his disciples to pray, he said, "Forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors." Forgiveness is so important that our very lives depend on it. One of the great stories of forgiveness in the Bible is the story of this woman who was caught in adultery, and she was about to be stoned to death. And yet she experienced firsthand the saving power of forgiveness. You know what, friends? When we forgive someone else, we cleanse our lives of bitterness, which can and does destroy the soul. You know, there's a beauty in forgiveness, and that is it blesses us when we receive it, and again when we offer it to other people. You know, the Bible has a great deal to say about God's forgiveness because of our sins. It is because that is where salvation really begins. You know, friends, forgiveness is God's means of letting go of the past and moving forward with God. If you have been deeply hurt, nothing will be harder for you than letting go. Friends, the message is clear. Unless we let go of the past, we are doomed to live there forever. Many of us today need this message. I need this message myself. Perhaps we've been living for years under the burden of remembered hurts. And perhaps some of the things that bother us even go back to our childhood. And perhaps some of the people involved, we haven't seen them for a long time. Perhaps even some of them maybe are dead. It may be a brother. It may be a sister. It may be your parents. It may be your colleague. It may be a husband or a wife, or perhaps someone who mistreated you at work. Friends, what we need today is to become great forgivers. Why? Because forgiveness will save your marriage when nothing else will. Forgiveness will restore your family when nothing else will. Forgiveness will repair a broken heart when nothing else will. Forgiveness can be a key to a closed heart. Friends, the invitation is for you and for me. Perhaps forgiving means that you write a letter. Or perhaps forgiving from your heart means you make a phone call. Or perhaps forgiving from your heart means you come to see someone face to face. Whatever it is, do it with God's help. With God's help. Friends, let go of the rope of anger and bitterness. As I close, join me as we sing this song, Search Me, O God.
Search me.